Late Life is a production of Twin Cities Public Television in partnership with Allina Health, whose Life Course project, funded by the Robina Foundation, granted the producers unique access to their ongoing research into late life care in Minnesota.
I think the population of cancer survivors would really surprise a lot of people. They're walking around among us looking like all the rest of us. They don't look like our perception of what people with cancer should look like.
It's like death or something. Most people just don't want to deal with it or talk about it.
Well, I finally accepted it. And that's the first thing you got to do is accept it. And then it's how you got to live with it.
There's a lot of public perception about it that is erroneous and based on old information about cancer, which is cancer was one shot. You got the one shot, they treated you, it either worked or didn't work. Well, that's not cancer anymore.
Cancer nowadays is not the death sentence that people used to think it was. That if they catch it in time, it can be more like a chronic illness.
There are people living their lives with a chronic illness called cancer. And for some of them, they're going to have shorter lives because of it. Some actually aren't. But all of them will have some consequence of their treatment, whether it's psychologic, how that changes our perception of the world and what we think about the control that we have over our lives, or physically changes them.
Depending on what you're assuming is going to happen or what you're expecting, and I'm kind of a fighter. So I just wasn't really ready just to give in to it. I want to be able to keep going on and being comfortable while we fight this thing and getting as strong as I can. You have to make do with what happens and just see if it's not going to stop me.
It seems late life is a time we only recognize in the rearview mirror. What if we could see that every stage of life is precious and better spent with our eyes open? We used to call cancer the C word because the very name equaled a death sentence. But over the past three decades, researchers have made incredible progress. Some may now face a journey of years rather than months, living with cancer as a chronic illness. All are facing the new challenge of living a fulfilling life with cancer. The disease and its treatment take a toll on the body, mind, and pocketbook. But each of the people you're about to meet find purpose and meaning living with cancer in between.
My name is Teresa Shelton, and I am 55 years old, and this all started in October of 12.
The doctors tell me that approximately 6 to 9 months before it was seen in there, that's when this cancer started to grow. It ended up at surgery 6 inches by 3 inches by 1/2 inch thick.
I worked in high tech for 30 plus years and worked for companies like IBM, Xerox. I just kind of knew something wasn't quite right. So I went in to my OBGYN. And she said, we see tumors, we're gonna do a hysterectomy. But I also like to have an oncologist at the ready just in case.
They told me I had a large tumor in the left kidney. He said it was fourth stage cancer, which is basically terminal. And that was pretty much a hard nut to swallow.
I was getting sicker and sicker and sicker, and so I went in and here I had cervical cancer, so he took out as much as he could take out, and he didn't do a hysterectomy because it would have spread all over.
But I had an amazingly wonderful doctor. I don't remember the first couple days after, but I remember after that him telling me, you're one of the most interesting and lucky people I've ever seen, because usually with a cancer piece that big, you have little parts of it that go underneath or we can't get to. And he said, we were able to get, let's just say, 99% of it out.
What was supposed to be a 2 to 3 hour operation turned into 8 hours. I didn't find out I had cancer until I woke up, which was, if you're gonna have it, that's the best way to find out.
I was devastated. Yeah, I was devastated, and I think more than she was, but it's my sister's faith and her positive attitude towards life that helped to keep me going.
still feeling okay, but it's not going away. They can't give you radiation, so they give you pills. First one I was on worked for like 2 years, and then I'm on the second one now, and that's been working for a year.
They did a biopsy on my liver, and there was another spot on my liver, so they had to do the surgery, and they got the cancer out that way, but he said if you were my relative, I would want you to do chemo.
The day chemo was done, I was on a plane for another meeting. So I think I brought the first reoccurrence, which I had, it had moved to a lymph node, on myself by just, you know, picking up as if nothing had ever happened.
I did chemo thinking it was only going to be 3, and it ended up being 6. It wore me down so bad, physically and mentally.
But then he did say, you know what, with this kind of cancer, it's going to grow back. So it's just a matter of, we'll see what happens in the future.
And I had to go back through another round of chemo, and at that point I thought, you know, I think God is trying to tell me something.
Everybody's going to have to deal with their mortality sooner or later. I feel fortunate that I was given the chance to at least have as long, you know, as much time as I've had and could possibly have quite a few more years.
Most treatments come with a physical shock to the whole system. Living well with cancer means finding ways to overcome this challenge.
Cancer treatment physiologically ages a person very rapidly. And patients will tell you this. They'll say, it's hard to get up in the morning. I'm tired all the time. My joints hurt. So the analogy is very real. It does physiologically age people.
One of the things that chemo does is it can make your bones weaker. And in my case, it's been more like arthritis. And suddenly sometimes I get up and I feel like 30 years older than I am, you know, and it's like, where did this come from? Exercise when you can, because some days you can barely, you know, walk from the kitchen to the bedroom, let alone think about exercising. But it does make you feel better when you're able.
With cancer, we've thought that's irreversible. In fact, it's not really the cancer. Some of it is effects of the biology of the cancer, but much of it is repeated medical setbacks, hospitalizations that they don't quite get over, and cumulatively at a certain point, it becomes very difficult to pull yourself out of that.
So I was in the hospital over Thanksgiving, and then it was what to do with me next. Were they gonna send me home or send me to a rehab?
Do you wanna work on balance next? Does that sound like?
The most common form of physical therapy is for weakness and what we call debility. General, people might think of it as deconditioning.
We just tailor their treatment to what they want to do. So it isn't so much that they have cancer, but that they happen to have cancer and we're dealing with, is there a certain type of exercise program you want to get back to? Is there something that new that you want to try? I just kind of ask people, what is it you want to do with your body? So Teresa's at once a week just because she does have a lot of other appointments. She has normally been a very active person, was cleaning houses, but she'd had some surgeries. And so when I first saw her, we were trying to get her back to that.
It's been really hard, because I can't work anymore, and I was just such a go-getter, and now it's just kind of, I don't do very much of anything.
It's for your arms, but also again for your trunk strength.
It's really about rebuilding muscle. Cancer treatment causes your muscles to get thinner and weaker, and to get them stronger, you have to use them, and you can get them stronger. Cancer doesn't make it impossible for us to improve our cardiopulmonary fitness or improve our muscle strength. It just makes it harder because of some of the symptoms and because they're so new.
Rehab was the best thing because I probably would have came home and did the little pity party and just rolled up in a ball and just hit away, you know, because there was no structure.
When we let people sit or not move after they've had a medical illness, they get worse and worse and worse, and then they are not able to take care of themselves.
You know, she had a recurrence, and when I saw her a month ago, our goals were, let's work on how you're sitting up straighter, let's work on you being able to sit for 10 minutes. So, I mean, she's really come a long ways.
I couldn't even hardly walk. When I got out of the hospital, it was bad. This is my second time around there. I went the first time and I had scar tissues, and Amelia helped. I was very glad I got Amelia back again, and it's been working out really good. They were just real impressed on how quickly I recovered and came back and how much stronger I got.
When I have a patient come into my office, I want to understand something about that person, who they are and what they want for their lives. In physiatry, my specialty of physical medicine and rehabilitation, I'm a function doctor. I treat all organ systems, but not with the idea that I need to make that one organ system better, but how do I make the organism function as a whole so that patients can achieve their goals?
I think it's helpful to have sort of short-term goals so that they feel like they can, you know, she feels like she can reach some. So, you know, she's working on the treadmill, she's working on those things, but she'd like to be able to just be able to have a fuller day and get out and do things.
When you do cancer rehabilitation and make a person less frail, that's less hospitalizations, that's less emergency room visits, that's less caregiver burnout where people are being institutionalized. So it's a cost-effective method of treatment.
Just by getting stronger, and just by her repeating some therapy stuff we do, that I'm doing it better and better and feeling stronger as I'm doing it.
The perception is, I've had cancer, I should just deal with it. I'm done with my treatment and I'm gonna try to get on with my life. And I think people don't always know that there are gonna be other issues that they have, and they feel guilty that they aren't just snapping right back. And so I think that there really isn't an issue too small to bring up, because there might be someone that can help you with that, either, you know, in terms of physical therapy, speech therapy, organization, just a variety of support groups and other issues. So I think that it's just good to know that there are resources out there for people.
What we're trying to do is intervene earlier, and not to look at cancer the way I think people view cancer as a death sentence. It's a chronic illness that's going to go on for some period of time, and we don't know how long it's going to go on, so we need to live while we're living and make that life productive, interesting, and enjoyable.
We purchase health insurance to deal with challenging diseases like cancer, but each new hopeful drug comes with a cost.
A lot of times people are middle class and their life is just going along well, as mine was. And suddenly you have this diagnosis and you're going from this doctor to that doctor, or this specialist to that specialist. And even though I had good insurance, I still had copays, and those copays are really mounting. And then some of the medications are either not covered or covered to a limited degree. To give you a for instance, I had one shot and it's $8,500 a shot. So you can see how things like that would add up quickly for someone who is already maybe borderline, or even if you do have financial resources, if you're having to pay out of pocket for things like that, it can devastate a family.
Your drugs are like $10,000 a month. Even the blood thinners was $100 a shot. Luckily, my insurance covered it.
Once I went out on disability, I was on Cobra. My Cobra went up to about $1,100 a month. And then I also had the copays at $50 per specialist, plus the medication was more expensive. So out of pocket, suddenly I'm looking at $1,200, $1,300, $1,400 a month. Toward the end, I just said, I can't do this.
Once I went on permanent disability, I could no longer keep my union health care. You go on Medicare, and then you need to buy supplemental. There's part A, B, C, and D. There's a booklet. It's huge. And when you go on that, then you have to make all these choices about which plan you want.
Thank God it was like only a month. And then Medicare kicked in for me, which has been a lifesaver, really. I mean, so I'm going from like $1,200, $1,300 a month down to about $300 a month. Much more manageable.
The Medicare comes out of your disability check. That's like $105 a month. And then I pay about $260 a month for my Blue Cross Blue Shield, and then about $15 a month for the prescription coverage. That went from a $1,000 deductible to $4,000.
The drugs are still pretty expensive. Like that $8,500 drug that I mentioned would still cost about $2,200 to $2,300. It's difficult.
I think there's a lot of people, and you hear about them, that make choices between food and between drugs, you know.
My church has helped me out twice now with gift cards. And then my sister put an email out instead of people sending me flowers or something like that, that we were more in need of a Cub gift card or money or whatever. So that helped.
Their bills come in not realizing how much their coinsurance really will affect them, especially if they get diagnosed at the end of the year, October. They have their coinsurance that they have to hit. Turn around January, they're going to hit it again. So they have a lot of bills.
My husband is able to take care of the bills, but it has been starting now, going into the savings that we have.
There is foundation grant money that is available based on diagnosis. So if it's breast cancer, there could be funds available, or colorectal cancer, pancreas cancer. They usually are drug-based. It helps with the chemotherapy, whether it's IV or oral. So pharmaceutical companies give funds to these different foundations. Some have 400% federal poverty level income. Another one is 500%. So they're pretty generous. Most people do get assistance.
The doctors, they have a lot of resources, but you gotta ask them and you gotta dig into it, because they're busy and they don't offer you everything unless you ask them.
Wherever someone is at, pick up the phone on the number on their bill and call and ask if they have assistance. Every one of those places probably got some sort of assistance available. And if it's not assistance available internally, there could be some other kind of assistance, or assistance with their copay or coinsurance on their drugs. So there are assistance. You just pick up the phone and call.
We face disease emotionally as well as physically. New complementary therapies and the understanding of someone who's been there can help us find our own path.
Welcome, everybody, and thanks for being here.
Take a couple of slow, deep, gentle breaths.
Pathways is an organization that works with people who are in life-threatening or really severe chronic health crisis situations. About 25 years ago, the founders, one of them had cancer, receiving primary care. They decided to explore the precursor to what became, I think, complementary therapies, paying attention to what they were eating, their exercise, how were they feeling about the cancer that they had, and how was that changing their life, and started improving their health in general. And they came back to Minneapolis and started Pathways, offering just the complementary side of things. Started small and grew into what it is today, which is about 160 volunteer providers who are coming from their respective practices to offer about 50 to 60 different programs or services under the movement, body work, art, music, grief, also to paying attention to quality of life measures.
I wasn't feeling good, and I'm very forthright with Dr. Mingi about telling him what's going on. So I actually called his nurse and I said, you know what? I just feel, I'll be honest, I feel sad and I feel alone. Can you suggest anything? And they suggested Pathways to me.
People come here in a really frail capacity, whether it's physically, emotionally, or both. We're very transparent with them. In orientation, I step up and I just say, what happens here is not curative. We look at it as healing.
My mind wasn't open to yoga or Buddhist meditation or a classroom where we can discuss the things back and forth openly.
A question comes up and you go looking for the immediate answer. And usually you do that by looking outside of yourself. As one of the resources, what we help you do is kind of look in the mirror again and say, what is it I can do for myself? Because we all have this sort of inner strength that we may not be aware of. And then it's sort of putting voice to what that is.
I always feel like everything is here for me, the brain cancer thing, all of my thoughts. It just, from there down, it doesn't feel like anything. By the end of the class, I feel like I'm not just in my head anymore. I'm just like one thing. And I know that sounds silly. The guys that I worked with would probably think that's a little unusual at the machine shop, but you know what? If you're open-minded enough to try different paths when you're in my situation, I think it's amazing.
I have this situation in life. So I can choose to let that situation or cancer or life-threatening piece be my anchor, or I can look for ways to help me shift to what do I have in my life that I should be focusing on.
I don't go to Pathways for them to cure my cancer. I go to Pathways for them to let me get through the day and to lead a happier life.
All right, so this week we're going to talk about healing energy. And, you know, after being home for about 3 months, I just couldn't sit around and look at the walls and think about this. So I decided to go back to school. I'll graduate in May with a bachelor's in social work. And because I had been at Pathways this summer, I thought this would be a great place to do an internship. What I do now is to meet with people a couple times a week and talk with them about needs that they may have, whether they're housing, medical, legal, and I can help them find resources that they can go to. So Rachel, we have a few resources here. Let me ask you, how soon do you need? We're so seeped in the idea of independence in our culture. We don't like to think in terms of being dependent, but often when we're going through a difficult illness or life situation, we don't have a choice but to be dependent on friends and family. So one of the things we want to do is to learn to be interdependent, not totally dependent, not totally independent.
And through that connection, you've got other people so that you're sitting across the room and saying, I'm not alone.
I'm getting more into the healing aspect of music now. I even ended up playing the harp for people while they were getting their chemo, which I really enjoyed doing.
The notion that some providers are coming here because not only are what they're doing is good for their participants, but it's good for them. It's an amazing process.
I'll just show you how it starts. I see an eye. I see an eye. I see a mouth. He also had me get together with an art therapist. The first time I met with her, she just said, you know what, TV is probably not the best thing in the middle of the night. That doesn't put you to sleep. You ever do any kind of drawing, anything like that? And I thought, are you kidding? I never do anything like that. 3 weeks go by and I just cannot sleep that night. I got out the, I call them crayons. I put something out in an hour that night and it didn't look too good. But you know what, I went right to sleep. Right now I have about 80 different drawings that I've done over the past few months, 4 months.
Everybody's voice is inside somewhere. Some are buried incredibly deep. And over time, whatever layers are peeled back, lets those voices emerge. Because it's all about the stories that people bring.
That was chemo third night. When I got done, I just went right to sleep then. And I got up the next morning, I thought, that's exactly what I felt like that day. Here's a day five of chemo. What does that look like to you? This is like the cancer guy. Don't ever think you're done. This is gonna come again. I put this on my Facebook actually. It was the night before I had my MRI, wondering what I'm gonna see out there, but I'm kind of standing hidden still. That's what I feel like. I don't even try to draw that though. That's the only thing that'll come out. Say you have something in your arm or in your head. That's where all of your emphasis is on the part that's hurting, right? Well, I have it in the brain. Do I feel tingling up in there? Sure, I do. That's the only thing I think about. When you find something else, whether it's a breathing or a meditation or art that moves you out of there, I think it's actually more healthy. It makes you feel better. Is that gonna help cure my cancer thing? I don't ask that question and I don't really care. What I wanna do is get through that day. And I kind of made an agreement this year. We'll see how close I can get to one every single day, whether it's the middle of the night or during the day. And I was told by the person that got me on this path, stack them up. And at the end of the year, put them in order and see if you can really understand what you went through that year by looking at that.
What they find here is not gonna, they're not gonna throw down their crutches or it's not gonna heal their cancer. It's gonna hopefully help. But it's all based on what they find.
So this coming May 15, will be 4 years since I found out I had cancer. And they say the life expectancy with stage 4 kidney cancer is like 2 years. So I'm doing all right.
It's really been hard for me to accept people taking care of me and helping me. And I'm getting used to it, but it was really hard at first. I kind of have told people that I was getting pulled down by my feet But I would raise my hands up, and God would take my hands and pull me up little by little.
Some people are just, they spend their whole time, once they get something like this, they just look forward to what's gonna happen. And I just thought, okay, let me just quit worrying about it, and let me just make sure every day I try and do the things that I can.
As you can probably tell, I'm a pretty positive person anyway, so I don't let a lot of this get me down for long, but you know, there are moments when it's just like, Faith, I think, is very important. I also think that attitude is about 80% going through this experience. And sure, it's not for sissies. That's why I'm looking at cancer as, okay, it's just one more challenge, and you know, I'm just gonna take it and take it for what it is.
Late Life is a production of Twin Cities Public Television in partnership with Allina Health, whose Life Course project, funded by the Robina Foundation, granted the producers unique access to their ongoing research into late life care in Minnesota.